There's something very topical nowadays, right? It's called healthcare reform. With the presidential election, there's a lot of discussion over repealing and replacing the Affordable Care Act, which begs the question, if you do repeal it, what are you going to replace it with? Well, we want to talk about some aspects of the current healthcare environment that are laudable and things that we would like to be able to promote. And this is stuff that, the stuff we're talking about tonight, in general, with the discussion on direct primary care and some of the self-funded insurance programs and Christian MediShare, these are activities that are already authorized under the current Affordable Care Act. There's ways to improve some of the coverage associated with that, but I want to highlight that, you know, remember when the Affordable Care Act was actually deployed, there were a lot of people who lost their insurance. You remember the, let's just say, misleading statement, it's a politically correct statement that says if you like your doctor, you can keep your doctor. If you like your insurance, you can keep your insurance. Well, my hope is that when we talk about repealing the Affordable Care Act, we protect relationships that are already working in that context. And some of those relationships that are already working, we're going to talk about tonight. And that's around these direct primary care services, around self-funded insurance plans, and around Christian MediShare. So you're probably looking up at this diagram up in the top going, okay, I'm not an ophthalmologist, so why are we doing a colorblind test here for everybody, right? And a colorblind test. And I know Dr. Jim's here, and he's probably sitting there. He can probably see the seven hidden in there, but most of us can't. This is actually an attempt at diagramming HR 3590, otherwise known as the Affordable Care Act. Each of those blocks, each of those dots in there actually corresponds to a section of that bill. And I'm one of the rare oddballs. Before I ran for office back in 2010, I actually read all 1,017 pages of HR 3200, which was the precursor to the Affordable Care Act. And since then, I've read the 965 pages of HR 3590, which is the Affordable Care Act. It is not a pleasant read. It is, I came to the conclusion pretty early on reading through this document that it's more to do about control than it has to do about care. And you can see all these different organizations that are there. Do you know where physicians and patients are on that diagram? Who's got really good eyesight? Dr. Jim's probably got that down. All right. Right over here is physicians. Right over here is patients. In between, the federal government, in their wisdom, added 159 new organizations between a doctor and a patient to make healthcare more affordable for everybody, because nothing says affordability like adding a whole new government bureaucracy in between a doctor and a patient, and nothing says care than having a bunch of bureaucrats tell you what treatments you can get or can't get in context of that care, right? So, and of course, putting all these organizations in between a doctor and a patient is going to increase costs. Of course, unless you, the only way you save costs on that is if you ration care. When you ration care, you get rid of the quality of care, so you lower the quality of care. We're going to show you tonight how to actually go off and lower the cost of health care without rationing care. Matter of fact, while improving care. And one of the reasons you get that lowered cost is because we're going off and attacking the key way that everybody here in this room understands is to lower health care expenses and make healthier people, and that is via preventive care, right? So if you get people that are leading healthier lifestyles and you encourage and you incentivize the primary care, you keep people out of the expensive side of healthcare, which is in the hospitals, right? And so that's what we're trying to set up in this framework. And essentially what it means is that all the folks in between, all those little dots in between a physician and the patient become inconsequential, at least in context of the primary care realm around healthcare. And that's one of the things we're going to be talking about tonight. So, why does this matter? And just so you know, why am I coming all the way over from this part of our state, up below the thumb, right? Why am I coming all the way out here to talk about this? And we've already passed legislation here in the state of Michigan. I led the passage of legislation around direct primary care services back in 2014 that essentially made sure that direct primary care is not treated as an insurance product, because it's not, it's a service. It's, and we're going to talk about what exactly direct primary care is with Dr. Savage here from Your Choice Direct Care out in Brighton here in just a little bit. But I want to highlight what really our opportunities are to go off and in the state of Michigan, because that bill is already passed, we don't have to pass any additional legislation. That's why we're in evangelism mode. I've worked with legislators in other states, in about six or seven states at last count, on promoting the same legislation so that if they're promoting these free market options, federal government will start listening to these free market options and open up additional options here in the state of Michigan. A lot of stuff you're hearing about tonight, I broadcast out at conferences out in Texas where we've gotten with legislators from all over the country, and we've developed a very good footprint of free market oriented doctors across the country, like Dr. Savage, like Dr. Roland Tindall, that are out here helping to lead the way on free market healthcare options, and that's what we really want to talk about tonight. But from a state policy perspective, why is this really important? Well, first of all, I'm interested in getting good care for everybody. I'm interested in going off and tackling lower costs. So how do you do this? Well, let's look at the fact that we have about a $31 billion healthcare market here in the state of Michigan. And there's 10 million citizens in the state of Michigan. What we're going to be talking about tonight, particularly just with direct primary care, has been proven to go off and lower the cost of healthcare by as much as 20%. And they do that by keeping people out of the hospital, i.e. with better care. If you can get a 20% savings on a $31 billion market, and so we're looking at it from an employer perspective, you know, we're saving about $6 billion per year for employers. That translates either to higher wages, improved profitability for companies, or at the very least, it gives you a competitive advantage over states in the area that makes Michigan a go-to place for job growth, for economic development. So I'll put on my, didn't think healthcare would have anything to do with economic development, did you? But that's actually very important. And where I live, we have a bunch of folks in Canada that tend to use the bridges that we have across there and tend to have difficulty finding primary care physicians, that this would open up a whole new branch of medical tourism for the state of Michigan as well. So there's a lot of opportunities just from a job growth perspective that if we can demonstrate that we know how to do healthcare better at lower costs, it's a big opportunity for us. So let's look at public employees. Now, here's a big opportunity. What if we actually applied direct primary care services in that 20% model that 20% savings model to state employees? Well, we could save almost $280 million per year. This is something we're going to be looking at doing in this upcoming state budget, is making sure that this is offered to state employees and offered to local municipal employees as well. Now, here's the biggie. The single largest line item in the state budget is Medicaid, $17.5 billion. You guys have all heard about Healthy Michigan, right? We've got 2.4 million people on Medicaid as a result of Healthy Michigan. How many of you knew that Healthy Michigan is going to be belly up in 2020 and is going to be repealing itself? All right, so Healthy Michigan was sold to us on the premise that it was going to provide certain savings. Those savings have not materialized. Senate Fiscal has done an analysis that the provisions of Healthy Michigan, the provisions that were passed into law, will automatically repeal it when those savings go negative, and that happens in 2020. And so what we're talking about is we have to fix our system here, one way or another. Federal government's going to be helping out with a lot of policy changes here soon. One of the policy changes that they've talked about is a block grant of Medicaid. Well, one of the areas that I've been very proactive on is saying, I would like to do a DPCS Medicaid pilot in state government. And so get about a panel size of about 2,400 enrollees of six different demographic groups and go off and prove it out that we can save at least 20%. And actually improve the care of the people that are on Medicaid right now and give them care, not simply coverage, because that's all Medicaid really does right now. It gives them coverage, not necessarily quality care. And so that's something you're going to hear pushed about or pushed in this upcoming legislative session. We got it all the way to the conference report last session, and then it was pulled out by leadership at the last second during the budget, so we don't have that pilot active right now. But we're going to give it another go this time and try to get it all the way across the fence. The opportunity for the citizens of Michigan is that we could save $3.5 billion. And I want people to understand, the way you save that money is not by rationing care and telling people what care they can't get. The way you get those savings is by improving the care and keeping them out of the hospital. radically different concept. So the idea that sometimes people think it's impossible to actually improve the quality of services while saving money, that's what exactly what we're trying to do with this DPCS Medicaid pilot. We're going to prove it out for folks if they give us the opportunity to do this. Now, there's a lot of folks that may not be too thrilled about doing this. So this impacts hospitals, for example. Where do you get those savings? You get that from cut expenses because people are spending less time in hospitals. So we're swimming against the wind, and or we're sailing against the wind. We could probably be swimming too, but I love mixed metaphors. So anyway, so there is an there are some headwinds that we're dealing with on this stuff, but I was elected to serve the best interests of the people of the state of Michigan, and that's why we need to go off and push policies that actually help the taxpayers, but also help the people we're ostensibly trying to help with the Medicaid program in the first place. All right, so, and the way you do that is high quality care. So here's all the different healthcare options that we really have right now. I'm not going to go into detail on it because I want to get to the people that are the folks that are actually working on the ground here on healthcare right now. They're the experts. I'm just dealing with policy. You notice I'm an aerospace engineer. Just because I read those bills. My wife, by the way, is Angie, is a pediatrician. So I do have some, you know, counsel, if you will, wise counsel with an MD degree behind her that helps me out. But I want to highlight, in the Affordable Care Act, there's a concept of these qualified health plans. Essentially, if you have a qualified health plan, the IRS doesn't knock on the door and say, give me more money, because in the form of a penalty, because you're not in accordance with the dictates of the federal government. And there's four different approaches on that. One is an exchange-based plan for for-profit insurers. You've got these consumer-oriented or consumer-operated-oriented plans. That's for nonprofit insurers. You've got government insurance, which is these community health insurance programs, and then you've got ERISA-based plans, which we're going to talk about tonight with Teresa McIntosh, and who's a wealth of information on the financial aspects of what we're doing. It goes beyond the primary care and talks about how you can do, has set up self-funded insurance plans that can benefit you. And then we're going to wrap up with Angie talking about Christian MediShare program later on. And speaking of Christian MediShare, one of the exemptions inside the Affordable Care Act, specific exemptions around Christian healthcare ministry. And so they're in a different area. And of course you can, you know, Medicaid and Medicare, and then you've got the open market. There's a lot of good things happening in Washington, D.C. if you're a fan of free market healthcare right now. Working with some of those doctors we were talking about before, we're working with them across the nation. We provided a list of free market healthcare advocates for every organization inside Health and Human Services, and we're happy to say that one of the co-founders of Docs for Patient Care and one of the people on our recommendation list that we submitted to the Trump administration, Dr. Tom Price, has been nominated for the head of HHS. That will open the door to a lot of the free market healthcare options we're talking about. And in regards to CMS, which covers Medicaid and Medicare, Dr. Seema Verma, who is responsible for the Healthy Indiana Plan, which is a very much an HSA advocate and who I was working with 3 years ago to go off and promote DPC in conjunction with HSAs as an opportunity to improve their plan even more, is now heading up CMS, according to the nominations, still has to get approved. So there are very good signals coming out of DC for the first time in a long time. And I'm looking forward to getting across the finish line there. So tonight, the framework for tonight's discussion, we're going to be divided up essentially into two parts. One is a primary care discussion that's going to be led by Dr. Chad Savage, talking about direct primary care services as a mechanism for delivering primary care services. And then the remaining part, because you can't just have direct primary care, you got to still have catastrophic care for what happens when you get hit by a beer truck and you got to go to the hospital, right? You still need that wraparound insurance. Remember, you still got to meet all the requirements of that qualified health plan to keep the IRS from knocking on your door. We're going to talk about what it takes to keep the IRS off your backs, and that's going to be, Teresa McIntosh is going to be talking about that, and also Angie's going to talk about the Christian MediShare option that we were talking about. But you need two components. So this is a framework. You need the primary care, which is about 80% of the healthcare transactions. You perfect that, and you're getting into pretty good shape for the rest of the healthcare system, right? And then we'll talk about what happens with the catastrophic care. So, if you want to find out more information, go up to morningofmichigan.com. That's my Senate website. That'll get you a lot of good information, including videos of this event when we get that done, but previous events as well. And there's one editorial in particular that I recommend that you read if you get a chance to kind of show where I'd like to see things go on free market healthcare. And it's an article I wrote for Forbes, and it's posted up there. If you can just go to Forbes.com and Google my name, you'll find it in there as well. But a lot of opportunities to improve healthcare that we haven't even tapped into yet.
So as I want to describe a little bit about what's going on in the system, I will say we give this presentation to all types of audiences. You guys are sophisticated as a lot of physicians, so a lot of this is going to be mundane to you. But I'll try to customize a little bit. You guys can feel free at the end to interject any points you have or questions you have specific to the practice of medicine. But I want to talk a little bit about what's going on in healthcare right now. You guys all have a very good vantage point of that. What direct primary care is and how we work with various insurance products to try to help be part of the solution, help decrease costs for people. So to begin with, what's wrong? A quick question. What should the practice of medicine look like? In the current insurance-based system, as we all know, doctors are overworked. Now, when I deal with my lay audiences, I usually say, you know, they have an interesting perspective of this. Oh, they're rich, you know, who cares? Let them work them like crazy. Well, for patients, when your doctor is overworked, this results in long wait times for care. The average wait time for primary care services in the United States is 19.5 days from the time of call to the time they're able to see the doctor. And that's because they're overworked. After all that waiting, they get the opportunity to wait some more. A recent study suggested the average person must set aside 3 hours of their day to accommodate a doctor's office visit. Drive time in, waiting in the reception room, waiting in the exam room, see the doctor, wait for checkout, and drive home. So that results in a massive loss of what's called opportunity cost. You guys all know what opportunity cost is? It's the value of your time if you were doing something else. Staying at work, being with your family. Most people have something better to do, in all honesty, than hang out in our exam rooms. And then after all that waiting, unfortunately, they're graced with 8 to 12 minute visits. So hurry, in and out. We all experience this every day. Why? Because we're overworked. Goes back to that first one. Pressure, got a full schedule, got to see people. But it actually, the problem goes beyond that. Because we're now distracted by unnecessary levels of documentation. We've gone so far away from the soap note of documenting what is pertinent and relevant to the patient and the conveyance of medical information and relevant to their care. Now we have to do all the CPT requirements, all the Blue Cross Blue Shield requirements, and a study recently showed that a physician's time, only 20% of our time is spent with patients. 40% of our time is spent on documentation. So what does that mean? We spend twice as much time documenting our visits with our patients as actually doing them. That's a problem. And as you all know too, there are now injected conflicts of interest. This is really coming out now. Blue Cross Blue Shield and all the others are coming out with their different quality metrics. And if you actually look at the quality metrics, a lot of it's based on utilization and things of that sort. So what that means, if you drill down and think about it, is there could be situations where you could be actually paid more to do less for your patient. High-tech utilization, right? You guys all know this one. MRI usage. Where if you order too many MRIs, that could be a ding on your quality metric. Even if you ordered it for the exactly right reason, you can get that as a ding on your quality metric, and it can hurt you financially. These are conflicts of interest we should never have with our patients. And I've never seen a graph that more succinctly described what has happened than this one here. Anybody ever seen this one? So let me explain it really quick. This is a study that was done between showing the number of physicians between 1970 and 2009. This is the brown line right here. That's us, guys. Those are the physicians in the United States. What's this huge yellow blob here that's growing like a fungus? This is the number of administrators in the healthcare system. And what you've seen here is a very slight increase in the supply of doctors over a 40-year period of time, but a veritable explosion of administrators. Well, what are those administrators? That's bureaucracy. The black line, that's per capita spending. That's how much each of us spend on healthcare each year in the United States. And as you can see, that line is much more closely trending with the administrative burden than it is us. So don't let anybody convince you that we are the problem. We are not the problem. We actually make more when adjusted for inflation today than we did 15 years ago. So actually the system costs less when we make more. So pay us infinity, it'll go to zero. No, okay. Damn. And this is unfortunately what this results in. The 800-pound gorilla of the third-party payer system, that's the government insurance company conglomerate that really runs medicine today, accompanying every doctor into every exam room every single day. And as you guys know, they dictate how fast we gotta go, what we can do, even telling us what medications, diagnostics, and other treatments we can do. Now, I wouldn't bring up a problem unless I thought there was a solution. And my recommendation is that we look at direct primary care. Have you guys heard of direct primary care? Okay, good, we got some. Well, hopefully I'll illuminate some people today. So direct primary care is a membership model of medical care, low cost. Most of us are in a fee-for-service model, or an ACO, or something of that sort. The problem is then you're paid at point of service. The beauty of a membership model is it's one payment for all your services. It's low cost, it's budgetable, it's predictable. What this results in is a direct relationship, you and your patient. We're getting that 800-pound gorilla out of the room. There are no billing hassles. It eliminates the conflicts of interest. It's a ramp price, it includes everything we do. We have small practice sizes. The average practice in the United States today, primary care, is anywhere from 2,500 to in excess of 4,000 patients per physician. We limit it to less than 1,000. Now people say, well, that's crazy. How can you limit it that much? This is not crazy. What we are doing today is crazy. This is a historic norm, 1,000 patients per doctor. Prior to 1980, the average doctor had around 1,000 patients in their patient census. So today is the historical anomaly with the high patient censuses. And what that means is that when you have a reasonable number of patients per doctor, that improves accessibility. If you want to have a reserve capacity anywhere in the system to accommodate those sick people, where do you want it? In the ER? Yes, you need some in the ER for the serious traumas. But when you saturate your primary care patient base, people can't get in for things that primary care can handle, like colds. So what does that mean? That, well, I can't get you in for 19.5 days with that cold. Go to the emergency room. So now we have the most expensive place to access care, with trauma teams and crash carts and nurses and everything waiting around for the person who shows up with a cold. If you want to have reserve capacity anywhere in the system, you should have it on the primary care level. Doctor and a nurse, it's actually the cheapest place to access care. And you can do that when you have reasonable patient loads. And it also results in extended visits. Most of us in direct primary care schedule in 30-minute and 1-hour increments. So no longer do you have the problem-based list of CPT. One problem today, you want to deal with more than that, you got to come back tomorrow. You can honestly see a patient and say, any more problems? And not in the back of your head, as many of you probably have had, where you go, oh, please don't say yes. Oh, please don't say yes. I've got to run to the next patient. Now you can actually legitimately say, any other issues, any other problems, and not honestly want to do it because you have the time. And it's patient-centered. Again, by having that direct relationship. So, and allows for innovative delivery systems, which I'll get into in just a second. So what does a membership model of medical care look like? Well, it includes all office visits. Now, why is this important? I would argue this is incredibly important. For people who've been following the literature, we know that when people have to pay for their medical office visits, and as their burden of payment goes up, what do? They use it less, right? Well, that's good in a way because now you're decreasing the expense on primary care services, which is, again, the cheapest thing to spend money on. But what you find is that you increase the expense by twice the savings that you get in primary care. You get double an increase in the cost of hospitalization because those people are now scared to use us. When they finally do come in, they're sicker. They're in more advanced states of illness, and they end up in the hospital more. So that's financially a bad decision, but it also has a massive human toll. Those are sick people. So in a membership model like this, they come in the first day, they don't pay anything. They already paid us in the membership. If they get sick and they gotta come in the next week, they're already good, they don't have to pay us anymore. And this is, so they end up hopefully utilizing us much more early in disease management. And so we're able to treat them and keep them out of the hospital. It includes all in-office diagnostics, EKGs, spirometries, pulse oximetries, all these things. Gone are the day of nickeling and diming. Do you guys know how much a urinalysis actually costs? You guys buy your supplies? It's about 10, 15 cents per urinalysis. But you have to document why you're doing it. You gotta put a CPT code on it. You gotta submit the claim, blah, blah. Oh my gosh, just include it. It's so cheap. It's actually cheaper to include it than to bill it out. And once you bill it out, that 10 cent your analysis is now $30. We include all in-office procedures. So if we need to do a basic joint injection, a basic biopsy, cryotherapy, ear lavage, all included. All things that we would classically do in a primary care office. If you need, I had a guy the other day, needs a catheterization. Doc, can't you do that? No, you do not want me doing that. Primary care services, all in, yeah, not the best idea. Do we want to keep people out of the hospital? That would have put them back in the hospital. And virtual home visits, which more colloquially are known as telemedicine. And you guys probably all know about this, right? Everybody knows this is good, right? We've got wonderful technologies now. Phone, email, Skype, all these things. Why don't we use them? Because nobody can figure out how to compensate for them. We have a billing code. I think HAP was the only one for a while who was compensating. I think it was $10. But if you look at the documentation, you had to get to do the $10. People just didn't do it. So what do people do? We tend to avoid the phone. Well, when you have a RAB model, membership model, they already reimbursed you for your time. So why do you care? You know, if they want to call you on the phone, as long as it's medically appropriate to handle it that way, well, why can't we do that? You know, that's great. Skype, whatever's convenient. If the new technology pops up and holograms can pop up in front of me the next day, we'll incorporate immediately. We do not have to wait for CPT to create a code for that. So let me give you an example of this. So imagine you're the patient. Imagine you wake up on a Saturday morning. And you were out in the garden yesterday, and you got this itchy rash, and you're thinking, oh gosh, I saw the poison ivy there, and oh, this is terrible, it's so itchy, and I thought I avoided it, but I guess I didn't. Oh, I wait till Monday and go see my doctor, but wait a second, there's a really long wait to get in to see them, and oh, this is terrible, maybe I won't get in until Tuesday or Wednesday, or geez, maybe I'll be lucky to get in this week. Oh, I can't stand it anymore, I'm just going to the ER. Wonder this model? Forget about it. You take out your camera, right? High definition, these are great now. Take a picture of it. Text it to your doctor. Hey doc, got an itchy rash in the garden yesterday. Think it could be poison ivy? Why, that it does look like poison ivy. Here's some triamcinolone ointment for you. You know, let me know if you don't feel better. Quick, easy, convenient, wonderful. Great for the patient, right? Didn't go to the ER. We'll do questions at the end if that's okay. It keeps them from going to the ER. Great for the doctor. Quick, convenient as well. But you know who else it's great for? The really sick person who did have to come in on Monday. And now, instead of having to balance that time with the really sick person and also squeezing in the person with poison ivy who you have to massive documentation with, now that person has more time that you can dedicate to them. It's the beauty of allowing the doctor to allocate their precious limited time resource as they know and they see fit to best, most adequately care for their patients. And so that's what we do, right? That's direct primary care in a nutshell. But we don't stop there. We've used our medical degrees to go out and see what else we can get to try to save people money. We get massive discounts on cardiac diagnostics, imaging, laboratories, and medications, including OTCs and vitamin supplements. And I'll be happy afterwards to explain to everybody how we do this. And if you want to replicate it, we will help you do it. So let's get some ideas of what things are billed at. So in the state of Michigan, MRIs are billed about $3,400. You may get a negotiated price of $1,200 through Blue Cross Blue Shield. We are able on the east side of the state, to get MRIs for as low as $275. In fact, we're now getting them as low as $240. We get stress echoes, which bill between $1,100 and $3,000 for $207. We get chest x-rays as low as $33. My wife is a pediatrician, and she called me. She knows I'm big into getting these things, and she goes, I'm filling out paperwork all the time for diabetic test supplies. It took me, my staff, like an hour to figure out how to get this coded. So I went to Walgreens' website, said, how much does this stuff actually cost? And I got there, and they give you guys realistic prices. This is their generic version. Their monitor, the generic Walgreens monitor with 100 test strips is $98. We're able to get them for $17.51, 100 test strips and the monitor, which if somebody's testing three times a day, that's an $81 savings every single month. Fosamax, $141 for the course of the year, we're able to get it for $13.56. CBC bills at $85. Anybody want to guess what we can get them for? How much? Close. You give me your lab, $3. So pretty close. So a little more on the pharmacy. I think the pharmacy is an incredible asset. It's on-site. You guys have the capability. If you have a medical degree and a medical license in the state of Michigan, you can get an additional controlled substance license, not the DEA. This is separate, where it basically allows you to dispense to your own patients. It's not that expensive. It's not that hard to get. And this is what you can do with it. We're able to get a month of Plavix for $2. We're able to get a month of Zocor for 57 cents. Flonase, Meyer had it on sale for $23. We're able to get it for $4.12. Flu shots for $9.99. Norvax, 35 cents a month. Z-Pax, $1.26, and you can, 27, you can see the rest. So, you know, what does this got to cost? It's got to be really expensive, right? A lot better than you think. We can do this as low as $39 a month, and we increase it a little bit based on age, but it's anywhere from $39 to $69 a month. And our practice gives our patients 2 months free if they want to sign up annually. Now, a lot of doctors will say, well, how can you do this? How could you possibly make ends meet at those kind of price points? So this is what I call DPC math. In the insurance model, if you bill a dollar, do you get a dollar? No, not even close. Normal collection rates are right around 60 cents on the dollar. So you get about 60 cents of that original dollar, you got 60 cents, or 60% of that original dollar, you got 60 cents left. But the collection of that 60 cents was not free. That can eat up as much as 40% of the 60 cents, which means when you're done, you got 36 cents on the original dollar. In direct primary care, you bill a dollar, you basically get a dollar. But what about the collection charge? Well, we run a credit card through the machine. That's about 2-3% transaction fee. So you end up collecting 98 cents on the dollar. Three times as much of that original dollar is going to medical care by just eliminating the middleman and being efficient in how we bill. So direct primary care works incredibly well with inexpensive, high-deductible PPOs, non-traditional health sharing organizations like MediShare, and the ERISA-based health plans, which Teresa will talk about in a minute. So a lot of people say, okay, yeah, what does this look like? How could you save money with this? So I'm going to show you a quick example of Bob. Bob's a great guy, 58-year-old diabetic. We all know diabetics need to be seen four times a year, checking their A1C. They're also likely to get infections, and they tend to get a vascular disease. 80% of diabetics die from heart attacks. So I wanted to find out, what under a direct pay model, what could you get the entirety of a year of a guy who needs medical care? What could we do that? So I compared, and I will tell you, it's hard to get prices. You guys all know this. So I went to various internet sources to try to get prices. So if you took all his visits over the course of the year, billing 214s, labs, the various medications, this is all what they would bill under the insurance model. This is what we're able to do under the direct primary care model. Massive reductions in the costs. When he gets sick, we're able to get stress tests and chest x-rays and the medications to treat that and the visit, original visit, and the follow-up visit. And at the end of the year, his total cost of the insurance model is $5,400. Under the direct primary care model, $853. All office visits, all labs, all meds, stress tests, chest x-ray, etc. Now a lot of you say, yeah, how's that going to look though? You haven't factored in the insurance yet. Insurance covers the physical exam labs. That's 100% true. So this graph shows you how these things work out. To explain this, the gray here is premium. The red here is what you end up paying in addition to the premium in co-insurance or other costs. So Bob went out initially and he was going to buy himself a gold plan because his thought was, I'm going to buy the gold plan so that when I need to use care, I don't have to pay for so much for it. But he has a 20% co-insurance even when he goes through the deductible. So he's got a $250 deductible, he goes through it, but he's still paying 20% of all the medical costs above that on false prices. None of that stuff costs as much as it's billed at. So he ends up paying $939 above and beyond this astronomical premium. So now he gets real smart and he goes, you know what? I'm going to get a cheaper plan. I'm going to get a bronze plan. And he's right. That's a much better idea. He drops about $6,000 in insurance premium cost by going down to the bronze plan. What's the problem with that? High deductible. Now when he uses services, he's getting a full whammy. He's getting 100% payment of that. So now we drop the physical exam, right? You guys know this. We drop the physical exam lab, so it's not the $5,400. So once you take out the stuff that the insurance covers, and you go to the what he's paying on the deductible, he still ends up paying $4,700 above and beyond that very high premium. What if he links a bronze plan with a direct primary care model? Now he gets the low premium and he's getting good prices. The problem here is getting bad prices. Get good prices. So get a cheaper plan with good prices. Now he only adds $829 on top of the premium, which, when you look, he got this expensive plan originally to save on the premium, but he actually spent more than if he just got rational pricing and got the cheaper plan. And if he's really smart, and I'm not saying this to suck up to MediShare since they're here, I use MediShare. It's Christian-based health sharing. If you're Christian, you can use this. If you're not Christian, can't use that one. But you can use Liberty. Liberty Health Share is a health sharing organization you do not need to be Christian to use. Now his premium drops, they don't call it a premium, it's basically a premium, to $2,400 a year because he's in a high risk range. It's actually cheaper than that if he was healthy. They charge you a little more if you're sick. And he only adds $853 on top of that. I did not include, and this one I dropped physical exam labs because he could still bill the physical exam labs to the lab here because he's using traditional insurance. They don't cover it here, but who cares? He adds like another $20. So his grand total, by just changing how he pays for it, that's all he did. He changed how he paid for it. I'd actually argue he's got better care. Bob can save over $10,000 a year, every year, by simply changing how we pay for the system. All right, to reiterate, so direct primary care, low-cost monthly membership, includes all imaging, all in-office testing, all diagnostics, telemedicine, discounted meds, discounted labs, discounted imaging, no billing hassles, and no conflicts of interest. The future under direct primary care. Doctors being doctors. Which brings me back to my original question. What should the practice of medicine look like?
Tonight is self-funded plans and how you can combine that with direct primary care for businesses to save an awful lot of money and provide excellent health care for their employees. So whenever we're talking about health care, there are several health care considerations that have to be considered. It's kind of like the analogy of the three-legged stool. If any one of these doesn't work, then the stool won't stand. So first we have to look at the patient, or in this case, the employee, because we're talking about self-funded plans. Secondly, we have to talk about the physician. And thirdly, we have to talk about the employer. So first, we're going to talk about the patient and what's important to them. The patient, they're looking at several different items. First of all, they're looking at, are they going to get stuck with an ACA fine if they don't have a qualified health plan? Secondly, they're looking at coverage. What is their coverage going to be? What is it going to be their out-of-pocket costs? And then lastly, the million-dollar question, can they actually keep their doctor? The second component is physicians. And physicians, they have to stay in business. And they are looking at a steady patient base, bringing in sufficient revenue in order to maintain an office staff, equipment, and supplies. You have to have that steady patient base in order to do that. And the major problem here is freedom from government oversight. And allowing physicians to act and take care of patients the way they were trained to. Lastly, we have the business or the employer. So, as far as self-funded plans are concerned, the business is looking at what are the options for providing a qualified health plan. Secondly, what is the employee coverage going to look like? This is important when they're looking at their current employees and also for attracting future talent. And thirdly, what is the plan going to cost? There's a cost to the employer, there's a cost to the employee. So they have to consider all of that. So what we're going to look at first is we're going to look at group health-based options, which is your traditional model or your basic commercial plans. We all know these, it's your United Healthcare, Cigna, Blue Cross, those are your commercial plans. So The acronym is a fully insured plan, which actually is a misnomer because everyone knows you're not really fully insured. Everyone has these high deductible plans, as Dr. Savage was talking about, large out-of-pocket costs, co-pays, deductibles, all of that. So you're not really fully insured. You could pay an awful lot of out-of-pocket before the insurance ever pays dollar one. But a fully insured health plan, the company pays a set premium to the insurance carrier. That premium is based on the number of employees you have. It's based on past risk. There's a lot of factors that go in. They pay that same premium every month for the year, and then it goes up every year after that. Next, the insurance carrier assumes risk for all of the future claims. So the employer is not at risk for if there is something catastrophic happens. The insurance company has to pay that. 17% of small employers choose this option. And you wouldn't think that doesn't sound like a very high number, but when you consider that the average annual premium that employers are paying is over $6,200 for single coverage, this was as of last year, and more than $17,000 for family coverage. So if you multiply that by 50, 75 employees, that's a lot of money that the employer is putting out. So why does insurance cost this much? The main reason is because of the qualified health plans are required to provide essential health benefits. What are essential health benefits? These are the 10 items that Obamacare said that have to be provided. So we're talking about maternity services, regardless of whether you're male or female. We're talking about prescriptions. We're talking, a lot of different mental health services. There's 10 different items that have to be included in a qualified health plan. So that significantly raises the price of your premium. So the alternative, self-funded insurance or self-insurance. Self-funded, self-insured, they both stand for the same thing. And what that is the employer taking the risk on their employees' medical claims. The employer is the owner of the plan, and the claims are 100% funded by the employer. Okay, that may sound a little scary, but in 2015, 63% of all workers, regardless of employer size, and 83% of large employers were covered by self-funded plans. In fact, the majority of patients, we see in our practice all the time, are covered by self-funded plans and they don't even know it. They're not even aware of it. So why are so many employers choosing to self-insure? There is potentially a much lower cost due to the employer designs the plan. They can design the plan the way they want to design it. They do not have to include essential health benefits, and we're going to get to that in just a second. They can determine, they can give that set point. How much does the employee contribute? How much is the employer going to contribute? They design the plan. There's no essential health benefits, so those maternity services for males, they can leave that out. They decide what they want to include. And there's no premium tax. Okay? On your commercial plans, the employer pays a tax on the premium. With self-funded, that goes away. And then lastly, they have protection via stop loss. There's stop loss insurance that can be set up for employers for either group or for individual. So it's protection against catastrophic claims. So if you have one person that has a major heart attack and they wind up in ICU and the claims are just piling up high, they have that stop loss protection to protect them against those extreme cases like that. And you can do that for individual or you can do it for the group as a whole. So how does self-funding work? So let's look at an example of 112 enrolled employees during a mature plan year. The total premium in this specific instance, the total premium paid by the employer is $970,000. So $970,000 premium annual for 112 employees. So in the traditional plan, in this specific instance, they had claims of $690,000. So where did this other $280,000 go? It went to the insurance as profit. In the self-funded model, we still have $690,000 in claims, so this is the same. They paid $130,000 in stop-loss insurance to protect them. They paid $30,000 for their TPA services or third-party administrator. So where did this $120,000 in savings go? It went to the employer. The employer keeps that money. So $850,000 is what this cost them for saving 12% just by going self-funded. So, self-funding and direct primary care. The most important part of any self-funded plan is to control your claims or your medical expenses. How can an employer control claims? Use free market solutions that include direct primary care. Free market solutions are all of those providers out there that offer discounted cash services. And it's more common than you would think. And then we also have the direct primary care, like Dr. Savage was talking about. By using direct primary care and cash-based providers, employers can save a minimum of 30% on medical claims. It actually can go a lot higher than that, as I'm going to show you in a minute. So let's take an example here of chest pain. So we have a patient that comes into the office for a chest pain office visit. Between the office visit, the labs, diagnostic testing, chest x-ray, blood draws, injection fees, all of that, a typical charge of $515 just for this one office visit. If you were to go to the ER, if you were going to urgent care, if you were going to a doctor who doesn't provide discounted services, $515 is what you're looking at. So what's the alternative? Go to a provider who offers discounted cash prices. So you can see the office visit here has gone from $172 to possibly $100. And you know, you see a discount all the way down the road. And right here, we wind up just doing cash, $337, or a savings of 35%. But there's another alternative. And that's using DPC. As Dr. Savage pointed out, by doing a DPC, you can save, look at these, zero, 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 because they're included in the office visit. So this $515 office visit using DPC went to $85. So let's look at the same example that we used earlier, the same 112 enrolled employees during a mature plan year. Total premium paid by the employer, $850,000. We just went through this. There's your $120,000 employer savings. Okay, now let's look at it with direct primary care. So you have, now your claims are reduced to 493,000. Here's your TPA of 30,000, your stop loss of 130,000. Here's your original $120,000 savings from over here. And now, because we've reduced the price using DPC on our medical services, we have $197,000 in savings from the claims. So now, we have $317,000 in employer savings. And this is using a low-ball figure of approximately 30%. So now we've gone from $850,000 to $653,000 for a savings of 23%. So you can see how, if you multiply this over a company, how the savings stack up. So let's go back and compare it to our traditional model. Total premium, we've got the same thing here. We've got the claims of $690,000, $280,000 that went to the insurance company in profit. And now self-funded plus DPC, this is what we just looked at. Now we've gone to $653,000 or a savings of 33%. $317,000 in employer savings. So let's look at a success story. This is Palm Beach County Fire Rescue. So they were established in 1984 with a merger of 8 fire control districts. They have approximately 400 employees. They started with seed money of $300,000, and they had many challenges to start. Their first year, they had a set of preemie twins that were born and just about wiped them out. They didn't know how they were going to come out of it, but they struggled and they did. Flash forward 32 years. So that's a long time they've been doing self-funding. The family premium, remember what we just talked about, the family premium through commercial insurance, $17,000. Family premium is less than $300 a month. Their rates have not been raised in over 10 years. They've stayed the same. They have a phenomenal benefits package, which includes stem cell storage at absolutely no charge. They found out, and no commercial insurance even does this, but they found out that to cure chronic illnesses or something that may happen in the future, the best way is by using your own stem cells. So they allow every member of the family, of the employer's family, to store their stem cells. There's a hospital there that does this. And so if they get sick years in the future, they've got that there, and that will help them recover. They continue to add benefits and grow reserves every year. Their reserves actually got to a level that they were able to eliminate their stop. They have so much in reserve, they were able to eliminate their stop loss protection 5 years ago. The bottom line is they did struggle for a couple years in the beginning. They had to make sacrifices, but a lot of the sacrifices they faced, we don't have to face anymore because we have better information. We have TPA services now that can help with all of this. They didn't have this at the time. So that is an excellent success story. So what is the solution to 1, 2, and 3? The patient, the physician, the business employer. It's self-funded insurance plus direct primary care. The patient receives good affordable health care, plus they're not paying an ACA fine. The physicians are free from government oversight and they can practice the way they were trained and satisfy patients, and the business provides qualified benefits that satisfy employees at a cost that they both can afford. It's cheaper for the employer, it's cheaper for the employee. So, where do you begin? You begin with a good independent TPA. I can't stress this enough. The TPA, the third party administrator, is the employer's partner in this whole transaction. They do everything from helping you design the plan to getting your claims data, your past claims data, so that they can establish a risk pattern. They are your partner in the whole thing. There are several different types of TPAs. There's ASOs, there's hybrid models, but the independents are the ones that don't use a PPO network. When you use a PPO network that is included with most of the ASO or the hybrid models, it automatically, written right in the contract, it states that you cannot get access to claims data. You need to see that claims data. You can't have, the employer cannot have a relationship with a direct primary care provider without that PPO standing in between them. It's contract language that's written in. An independent TPA allows you to be free of that contract language. So an independent TPA is where you need to begin.
What is MediShare? I don't know if many of you have heard of it or not, if you're familiar with it, but I'll go over it quickly. MediShare is basically, it's just affordable, biblically based healthcare with a membership community that has over 215,000 members currently. They're dedicated to sharing each other's medical needs. It's not insurance, and I have to clarify that. It's a membership-based Christian community that share each other's medical needs. And it's also not new. It's been around since 1993. To date, more than $1.4 billion in medical expenses have been shared by MediShare members. There's currently over $20 million per month, as much as some of the smaller insurance companies. that are shared in medical expenses each month. We don't have to maintain a profit margin and keep stockholders happy. MediShare operates as a nonprofit, and that's why it works. It's actually the way it's supposed to work. It's the way Christians are supposed to share each other's medical expenses, and that's the way God designed it. So it works so well that 100% of the qualified medical expenses that have been presented through MediShare have been paid since its inception. And it is ACA qualified. There are no ACA penalties. There was a special provision written into law. I believe there are five medical sharing companies that are under that provision, that special provision, MediShare being one of them, that are exempt. And so you can comply with that law while maintaining your principles, and in most cases, you will save money. Because we're not insurance, we don't use insurance terms. We have what's called an annual household portion, which most people would think of when they think of it as a family deductible. We have the annual household portion is the part that you pay for your whole entire family. It's not per individual in your home, it's per family, unless of course you're a single person. And it's an amount that you select based on what you're comfortable with and based on what you feel like you can pay in your member share per month. But of course, as your annual household portion goes up, your share would go down, your monthly share would go down. And after you meet your annual household portion annually, there is no sharing limit after the first month. Members share in 100% of the eligible medical expenses after you meet that annual household portion. There's no 90-10 or 70-30 or 80-20 after that. You meet that portion. And there, another thing about MediShare, there's no lifetime limit on sharing. Even with most insurance companies, you're going to have a lifetime limit on how much you're allowed to have paid through an insurance company. With MediShare, there is no lifetime limit, so it's unlimited. And if you have a medical emergency, you know how quickly those bills can escalate and put you up over $1 million rather quickly. So,
should we push the button here? There we go.
We do work with one of the largest PPO networks in the country. It currently has more than 700,000 providers, but you are not limited to a certain area. You can travel if you need to, and you can still go to a provider on that in that PPO network. And if you choose to go to a doctor that's not in the network, you can do that. Your max out-of-pocket is 3% or $500, whichever is less. And we use technology with MediShare in a way that others don't. There's no prepaying with MediShare. You're actually provided with a card that you present to your provider. And the provider bills MediShare directly, and MediShare will process that bill and apply any available discounts. And then after you've met your annual household portion, those bills are made payable for sharing. And we also do have the feature of the 24/7 access to doctor consults as Dr. Savage was talking about, by video or phone. But we use a service called MD Live, and that also is included with your MediShare membership. We also have maternity costs that's shared 100% after membership has begun and your annual household portion has been met. And MediShare also has a very generous adoption benefit that's unique to our ministry. All regulations with MediShare are voted on and determined by the members, and the members decide what benefits they feel are important to have and adopt for the members on the team. And adoption, for instance, was one of the things that they thought was important. And along with that, they also have certain things that they feel shouldn't be covered. And of course, being biblical, it would go along with biblical guidelines for sharing medical expenses. And there are also limitations with pre-existing conditions. Primarily, it has to do with a waiting period, and if you have some specific concerns with that, you can contact us afterwards or come back and talk to us. We'll be there if you have specific questions. MediShare is basically a testimony of the way that God's worked through the service of his people when we share our lives and our resources to care for one another in our Christian community. We can use that testimony to influence others in our culture. It's not insurance, but it's biblical, affordable, ACA penalty exempt alternative that may be the best choice for you if you're looking for medical insurance or medical bill covering. Get call insurance. If you want to learn more, you can see us at the back, or you can look us up on our website.